Talking about ideas, have you ever wondered where an idea actually comes from? It doesn't have to be one of these big concepts, but just a little light bulb moment that lightened up your day or that of others. What was the last time you had an idea like that? What was the last time that you touched somebody's heart? You made an impact by what you said or by just being there for them. Think about that for a moment. And what was the last time that you felt intensely happy? You felt a total peace with yourself? That feeling of profound contentment. Now, these moments, how much did they cost you? How much effort, how much planning went into creating these moments? It's amazing. All the good stuff, all the moments of real value are for free. Don't take a lot of effort, and certainly happen without any planning. They happen in the gaps. So now we must ask ourselves, why is it that we run around all the time with our schedules filled back to back? I want to talk to you about our hidden human potential and how we're so damn well capable of hiding it. My story, my journey of discovery started in the corporate world. After my study business economics, I joined a very successful company, and I was able to contribute to defining and implementing successful strategic concepts. And it was great. I had a great time. I was part of being in one big family. I thought I was a real corporate guy. Then 4 years later, that company was taken over by another company. And some of my colleagues and myself, we were asked to come and work in head office to help spread that success to other countries around the world. I was in my mid-20s, great for my ego, but I can assure you it was for a very short time. I experienced the four most unsuccessful years of my life. It was really a lesson in humility. Not easy years, but it did set me up for the rest of my life. I was fascinated that we were completely unable to implement our great strategies in other countries that are exactly the same markets, same products, same competitors. And that's when I came to the insight, to what I call the iceberg phenomenon. Surely, great strategies in a company and great smart concepts are very important, but they don't float without a solid foundation. And that foundation in the corporate world is called culture. Something so intangible, you can't put it in a plan, let alone put it in a spreadsheet. I was so intrigued about this phenomenon that I decided to quit my career and set up my own company to help organizations to unleash that potential underneath the waterline. But how do you do that? What is culture? What is it made of? How can you turn it around? Well, I didn't have the answers, but I found myself in good company because I looked around in the marketplace. And this was the 90s. Every company had a cultural change project going on, one on another. Nobody seemed to have the real answers. But we had something more powerful than answers. We had questions, and loads of them. And we started to talk to our clients in an open process because we had nothing to sell. In a market where everybody was selling formulas, I started a company without. And I tell you, it makes for a different conversation when you have nothing to sell. And in this process, we were able to get to the core of the problem. And in a process of co-creation, we would mold together a solution that would fit. Sometimes we were involved, sometimes not. It was not as profitable a business concept as the guys who sell the formulas, but it worked. We redefined the role we played in the market of human resources and management development by going back to the very basics of that word, development. Anybody in the audience know where the word develop comes from? Well, don't worry. 9 out of 10 HR directors and management development managers don't know either. And that's a worry. The word develop means to unfold. Or for a German-speaking audience here, entwickeln. It's about taking off the wrappers that hide our true abilities. It's about dismantling the things that are in the way to be real with one another. And so we de-intellectualized the whole process of learning. And we came up with a new term, unlearning. It's not about the new skills. It's about taking off the layers of conditioned behavior that stand in the way of your true potential, your authentic self. And here we are. We were a small player in a big market. But our approach started to make an impact. We ended up in the boardroom. I remember the first time it happened. It was one of my big customers, and I was invited to join a boardroom meeting, a board meeting that was about a McKinsey report into the culture of the organization. And I remember entering the room, and I could feel that this culture topic was a big thing, was a hot topic. And there was a heated debate going about the conclusion of the report, that there was no trust in the organization. And as all the executives were talking about these flow charts and 3D models about to fix that problem, I was just sitting there and looking. And then the CEO asked me for my opinion. And I asked him a question. I said, how much trust do you reckon is there between the individuals around this table? And how much trust do you think as a group you'll pass on to the next level? It was very quiet. And we had a really good discussion afterwards. But to me, it was a great eye-opener. I saw the leadership iceberg. See, you can't change a culture from the mind. In fact, you can't change anything under the waterline if you're not prepared to come down into your own iceberg. Leadership is all about role model behavior, and not just in the corporate world. The same applies in the classroom or even at home. It's not about what you say. It's not about the way you say it, even. It's about how you make people feel. But what do? With leaders who have made their way up to the ranks by being the smartest in the room, who live here. You can just tell them, now you have to live and speak from the heart. It's like saying to a mind, you have to get out of your mind. So for those who were interested and keen to go on a journey with us, we would take leadership teams for 4 days to a cabin in the woods or to a hut in the mountains, offline. And we actually took out the program altogether and created a process, an intuitive process, where we could talk about the real stuff that keeps people apart. See, leadership is about how you work with each other in the moment. It's not a skill. It's not a trick. It's more like a reboot. And the biggest impact we actually had is when we started to work with leaders on a physical level. So not only the topics came on the table, but the leaders came actually on the table too. And we started to work with them, making them aware of their ability to sense, feeling their feelings, sensing the energy of themselves and people around them. We started to make them aware of the laws at work underneath the waterline. Around this time, I started to go through a shift in my personal life because I became a father of 3 children. And looking at these children, I realized how we come into this world with a perfect awareness and a great ability to sense. And I thought, oh my God, if I see what I see every day in my life, how do I want my children to be educated? And my wife and I were really wondering, what kind of an upbringing we want to give our children? And there were other questions, like what it is that we were actually contributing to the world that they would grow up in. And as we were going through all these questions and had in-depth discussions about the bigger picture and how we want to do things differently. Out of the blue came an invitation to meet some Native Americans in Upper Michigan. They live somewhere near the Canadian border, and my wife said, "You go. You're always coaching other people. Don't you think it's time to invest a little bit of in yourself?" And so I went. She must have thought that it was time. I went, and in the week I was there, a whole different reality opened for me. I realized I knew hardly anything about the intangible world. And I was taken by the wisdom that was still present with these people. And I came back after a week and slept, but I was thriving. And enthusiastically, I sat down with my wife and I started to share all the things I experienced. And I told her how I thought I was so much to learn from these people. And she was just sitting there and she smiled and she said, "It's time to pack." And I said, "What? What do you mean?" She said, "Look at you. Isn't that what you teach people? To live from their heart and follow their heart?" Well, long story short, we packed up. We sold the house, sold the business, and we moved to the woods for a simple life in nature. And this is how we lived. You're not taking me seriously, but this is what a lot of people thought we lived, because this is how all Native Americans live, right? We just lived a simple life in the woods for 4 years, just living with nature, with no other agenda than to learn. There was no next big thing. That was the hardest thing for me personally. There was no next big thing. The inner journey of just letting go of who I thought I was and just learning to be. And then we met this man, Nowatan, a medicine man who lived way out in the woods, the teacher of our friends. And that man made such an impact on us. The source of wisdom and knowledge he was able to tap into, seemingly effortless, was beyond me. It gave intuition a whole new meaning. And somehow I started to see that this intangible world had an amazing organizational grid to it, that this is where you can develop your own search engine to. And I was confused about a lot of other things, like his name. Nowatan means he who listens. Well, we usually had like 12-hour sessions with him, but it was him doing all the talking. And the few questions I had, he usually ignored. It took a little while to figure out, though, what the word listen really means. But then we started to see that on our way back to the woods, 3 hours in the car, we started to see a pattern. He had actually addressed all the questions. We hadn't even started to formulate the questions we had here. You see, in the time that I was there, and we lived with these people, we were starting to understand that dreams and visions are the ones that really guide you on your path. And we experimented with it, and a big vision did come. A vision that people like Nowatan, wisdom keepers, are disappearing, and their wisdom has to be captured, has to be filmed. But that's kind of a big thing to do. You know, who are we to take on such a task? But dreams kept coming. And by now you know my wife, so you knew what happened. We went on a journey around the world for a year, one backpack each and a camera, with our 3 children. And we tried to find these people. It's not an easy thing, because you know, you can't go on a web and say, "I want to find some wisdom keepers." We had to go out there to these tribal communities and see if we could get access. And the amazing thing happened, that what we thought was our additional challenge to travel with children rather than a crew actually was a door opener. We got access to communities we would never have gotten access to had we come with a film crew. We stayed with an Aboriginal family on an island for many weeks. We lived with the Bushmen in the Kalahari Desert. We witnessed miraculous healings. But everywhere we came, what surprised us most is how welcome we were in those communities, as if we were part of the family. It was a great lesson, this whole journey, in how things materialize. That the real good stuff happens when you get out of the way, when your wanting is out of the way. It's amazing how things have a tendency to just fall right into place. And we did meet some amazing people, some beautiful wisdom keepers. Like this lady, who actually called me yesterday. And this always happens when I talk about her or really think about her. And she tells me, we really don't need those telephones, but it's so lovely to hear your voice. The one thing that struck us most of meeting all these people is that it felt like talking to the same person over and over again, telling us the same stories, thousands of miles apart, having the same view on life, the same vision on the world we live in. Now, how is that possible for people who have no connection between them? Or is there? Now, that's hard to fathom for us who live in a mind-driven, tangible reality where we think we are connected when we have Wi-Fi. We live so in the tips of our icebergs that we don't even know how many beliefs we have that keep us there, and a vested interest in our society, trust me, to keep us there. They live in a complete different reality. Their belief system is based on the laws of nature. And they tell us that everything is connected, that everything is energy, everything is spirit. And all the powerful phenomena, like telepathy, intuition, and healing, they're all based on that connection under the waterline. And that's where the iceberg came back. The wisdom keepers actually told us there is three basic human abilities that we all have, and they live with it day by day, that make us who we are, and that help us manifest in this world. And the first one is our imagination. The most powerful energy we can unleash is the power of imagination, the power to have dreams and visions. And if you go back to my first question, where our idea comes from, it doesn't come from the mind. It comes to the mind from that intangible space. When Watton says, it's when you get the garbage out of your head. And there's two abilities that will help us to manifest our ideas. One is faith, the ability to see the solutions before you see the obstacles. Because the best way to manifest things is to see the reality you want to see and living from your heart. The unconditional love we felt with those people, I will never forget. And so we came back after 4 years, and we had something to do. We had to make a film. Our children had to go to school. And we worked for 3 years, three times longer than the actual journey, to cut 200 hours into 90 minutes. And then Ted comes along, Rupert over there, and he said, we need it in one thought. I'll give you that thought, but I'll first show you a little preview of the film.
We had a beautiful way at one time, how we viewed the world. Somewhere along the way, I think the original teachings got lost among all people.
Dom, take it.
Staying in the room and depends on what you're doing, what you're doing, what you're doing, what you're doing. So, Martha, we're not doing it.
It's up to the people all over the world, the common people of the world, to bring about a change, going towards the way of peace.
Thank you. See, my wife and I, we've been thinking about this when we had to think of the title of the film. And I think that's where the answer lies. Because what's so unique about these people and being with them is it's so incredibly down to earth, so humble, so lighthearted, carrying no anger, no judgment, no drama. But to get there, they had to deal with our one and only enemy we have. And it's only a three-letter word. So here comes our thought. Could it be that the single biggest contribution that we can make to this world and the future of our children is to get rid of that? Because what would a world be like where our children learn that ego is just a thing we can let go of, like we grow out of, like adolescence? What would a world be like where we become the inspiration, teachers, parents, leaders, showing that we don't need this? What would a world be like where this new generation can see that it's okay to just be and you don't have to become someone? What would happen to consumerism when this whole new generation is not so damn insecure that they need to surround themselves with a lot of stuff and just go out and buy the stuff they need? What if they know there aren't really any mistakes to be made and they would go out and explore because they know that failure doesn't exist? What if they know that the deal about life is not giving the right answers, but asking the right questions? What would a world look like where a new generation would see that giving is really receiving, and that you and I are just two sides of the same coin? What if we would get to a stage where there is so little ego that we don't need to own anything, and that we realize that everything is just on the borrow? I hope you find that an idea worth spreading. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Rolf, for giving us this very nice perspective. So you talked about children. Mm-hmm. You went traveling with your children. How did they experience this trip?
They didn't find it anything special, really. You know, they couldn't understand the fuss, people asking them afterwards, like, oh, you went here, my dear? Yeah, of course he went there. My parents went there. And meeting all these children, different tribes? Yeah, of course, we hang out with them. It's now that last week, actually, my younger daughter said, Dad, I wish you could do it all over, because at the time, I didn't realize how special it was. Mm-hmm. I think that's what children are about.
Thank you very much, Rolf WInters.
Thank you. Thank you.